Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, so let's start. Okay, so let's look at the homework, right? So one thing is, some of you said that you had trouble listening to our video. So Faisal, please explain. Kya hua? Video kyun nahi chali? So why didn't you complain immediately? Okay, so if the audio is not good, so why didn't you immediately let us know? You watched the other video? Which was the other video?
We had to watch two videos, one for characteristics.
And one for the functions. So which one did you watch?
Both from YouTube.
You watched both from YouTube?
Yeah.
And they were actually on Daily Motion?
No. There was a video on YouTube as well.
There was a video on YouTube as well, and you went and you did that.
Yeah.
So now the task is done.
I did it.
So why didn't other people do it?
I watched it last night.
Well, you did watch it last night? No. But when you watched it last night, was the voice okay?
Well, you had to concentrate.
Okay, awesome. You should concentrate. So now how do we resolve this issue?
It was more of the same thing? Yeah, we were telling stories.
Okay. Because the quiz is not going to be from the text, it's going to be from the stories. Yeah, it's going to be on the video. Okay, so guys, I'm going to give you one more day. So we'll take the quiz tomorrow. Are you guys all happy?
Sure.
Now, if you have any issue with the video, do you have Mr. Faisal's telephone number?
Hamza has that.
Okay. So now, alhamdulillah, today is a great day that today everyone will have Mr. Faisal's mobile number. Okay. Faisal Siddiqui. Hold on. Faisal. 0-321-2166-319. Okay, for the virtual students watching this video, that's Faisal's number. So if you have any issue with any videos, call him and he'll actually help you out, right? He has all of this database of these videos. Okay. So what else did I give you as homework? Okay. So who's going to actually explain that to me? So where is the mic? It's right here. Okay. Okay, before we start, you know, we have this small policy that we'll introduce our guests. His Honor. We'll introduce our guests, right? So Dr. Saab, can you introduce yourself to these beautiful gathering?
Assalamu alaikum. My name is Mohammad Hanif Chatni. I'm an eye surgeon working at eye department in Patel Hospital, Karachi. And I've been affiliated with Timelenders for last 11 years, I think, now. And I've done all the workshops and vision retreat and sleep management and time management, vision workshops.
MashaAllah.
And they've really made a tremendous difference in my life. Thank you.
Who is the head of your department where you work?
I have been made responsible to, you know, do the administrative and clinical affairs of the department.
Okay. So the person who is responsible for the administrative and clinical affairs, is he also called the head of the department?
Yeah, I'm the director of the eye department.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you head that department?
Yeah.
Okay, mashallah. Okay, we welcome here, Dr. Saab.
Thank you.
So if any one of you needs a good eye examination, Dr. Hanif is here. So welcome to the Timelenders resource. Dr. Saab, can we give you a number to these people?
Please.
Okay. So, it is very good to go to people who you know, right? Dr. Hanif.
Let me give you the number which is sort of, you know, more helpful when they need to. It's Mr. Saeed.
Okay. So, Saeed.
Yeah.
So, he'll help with everything?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. Zero?
Just hang on. Saeed, Saeed. 0332 361 5732.
Okay, good.
Thank you,
Dr. Saab. It's a pleasure that you are here.
Thank you.
Can you introduce yourself quickly?
Assalamu alaikum. My name is Evan Masroor, and I'm a technologist. That's all.
You're a technologist. Okay.
Sort of.
So welcome, Mr. Technologist, to this group. Thank you. So I'm trying to actually hire this person as my CTO. So I invite him to come here. Okay. So who's going to speak about abundance versus scarcity mentality? Balash Saab.
All right, so scarcity mentality was an idea. It's actually taken from Stephen Covey's 7 Habits of Highly Effective People. All right, so it's a zero-sum paradigm where people...
What does zero-sum mean?
There's a different definition that I thought of it. Zero-sum paradigm literally means that... how do I put this?
Suppose I do not know English, suppose, and you say it's a zero-sum paradigm. What does it mean?
I'm trying to put it in words.
Okay, no problem. Who can help put this in words? Like, Priya. Okay, Priya. What is a zero-sum paradigm?
Sir, it's basically a win-lose mentality that if one person gets something, it will be it won't be available for the other person, or lesser would be available for the other person.
Other person. So what is the root of this phrase zero-sum?
So it means that, you know, if you like two people, they cannot get the same thing, or when if they work together, no more would be created. Instead, if one person gets a bigger share of the pie, lesser share of the pie will be left for the other person.
Okay, very interesting. Okay, Balash, we'll let you continue. Okay.
So people with scarcity mentality actually have difficulty in sharing in a way. So they have difficulty in sharing credit, profit, anything of the sort, even if the person is directly related.
But what is the dominant paradigm that the person has that creates this mentality?
Is that if it's shared with someone else, there'll be less for them.
Yeah, but that's a reality. That's a result. But what's the dominant paradigm that makes this mentality come up?
I think it's power and recognition.
Okay, very good, very interesting. Yeah. So what is the dominant paradigm behind the scarcity mentality?
Well, again, the dominant pattern is that the resources are scarce.
The resources in this universe are scarce.
And if, for example, you are working in a company and your colleague is getting more pay, so, you know, you cannot get more pay. Because he's getting it, and that's why he's getting it, and you cannot get it. The resources cannot be shared, or cannot be created. More resources can be created. Therefore, someone's gain is your loss, and your gain is someone else's loss.
Okay. And what is abundance mentality?
Abundance mentality is that resources are in abundance, and you know if we share. And you know, help each other, we can create more resources.
Okay, good, mashallah. So what implication would this have on your behavior? So if a person has scarcity mentality, Hassan, what sort of behavior will he exhibit? And if a person has abundance mentality, what sort of behavior will he exhibit?
The person who has scarcity mentality, he would be jealous.
And a person with abundance mentality, what? Good. Okay, so let me just summarize this. System B, classical system B, is afflicted by the scarcity mentality. Okay, and that is why this whole economics and, you know, everything is scarce, everything is finishing, you know, the oil is running out, air is running out, and water is running out. So, you know, so there is so much of this fear that is so insidious, you know, so, and it's also invisible, that is affecting the way that we operate. You see? And we want to compete, like he said, we are jealous, we feel sad when we see somebody else. So if I see somebody driving around in a Mercedes, I'll feel sad. Why? Because if he is getting the Mercedes, and if the pool is limited, which means there's less for me, right? So suppose there's a ship or a boat, and they run out of water, and there are, say, five people on the boat. They run out of water, and there's only like 2 gallons. So, if this guy, out of thirst, requests that, can I, instead of having one glass, I'm very thirsty, can I have 2 glasses? So if this person, one, is a scarcity mentality guy, what will he think?
He's taking my portion.
Yes, he's taking my portion. That's not fair. It's unfair. We are running out of water, and we have decided to take 1 cup each. If you are thirsty, well, suffer. For God's sake, suffer. That's not fair because he's taking from my share. Now, if that, remember I told you that behaviors are built on what? Attitudes, right? And attitudes are built on what? Beliefs. So paradigms actually come here, right? So this is the mental level where we operate. That, yeah, that's the mental level of operation, right? So beliefs and paradigms and assertions and whatever suppositions, they come all here. Attitudes are one step up, and then finally they manifest themselves in behaviors. So the guy with the scarcity mentality is going to first get those feelings, right? And he says, well, he's taking from my share. So he may be polite, right? He may be very polite. Now, did you guys get my Facebook post about last Sunday that I was at Taqi Usmani Sahab's talk? Are you guys connected with me on Facebook? You don't get my post?
No.
Oh, why? What sort of connection do you have? Are you connected with Suleman Ahmer, me, or Suleman Ahmer, somebody else? So you're not getting any posts that I'm... So do you think that Facebook is failing sometimes in delivering posts? I don't think so, yeah? So why don't you do this? There's a system where you go into controls, and you, in for my account, you say see first. So what's going to happen, that every time I will post something, it'll be on the top. So can you guys make that change? Can you promise me that you'll do it? Okay. So when I went to this talk, phenomenal talk here, unbelievable. I mean, I was just blown away. He actually, in just less than an hour, very eloquently explained the difference between the difference was, and I'll tell you how it relates to this discussion. He said that the difference between husn-e suluk and husn-e ikhlaq. Husn-e suluk and husn-e ikhlaq. Husn-e-suluk means manners, your manners, your outward etiquettes, Q-U-E-T-T-E-S, Priya, is that correct? Okay. Manners, outward etiquettes, being polite, your politeness, that's husn-e suluk. And he said, husn-e ikhlaq, ikhlaq, I don't know even how to translate this into English. What is ikhlaq? No. The issue is that sometimes, you know, a language will not even have words for certain concepts that could be in another system. So one system has its own ideology and, you know, paradigms and beliefs and everything, and it will have its own language. The other system will develop its own language. So if there's a concept that one system does not have, it will not even have the language for that concept. English is so poor that it doesn't even have an articulation for ikhlaq. You'll always have good manners, politeness, you know, but that's not the case. And honestly, this is the first time that I'm even learning it, last Sunday. You guys missed something huge. And you know, ladies can also come, do you know this? This is an arrangement for ladies also. Okay, anyway. So he said that the Prophet ﷺ came to this world to perfect not husn-e suluk, but to perfect husn-e ikhlaq, for the perfection of this. And he said, what is ikhlaq? Ikhlaq actually is the inner state of a person. Inner state of the heart. So if for somebody to have good ikhlaq means that his inner state has to be good. For example, he said, that a person may be very polite. So I'm meeting you, MashaAllah Balash, such a pleasure to see you. I'm so happy to see you, Balash. My God, how are you? I'm so polite. But if in my heart I have envy, hasad, then this is not husn-e ikhlaq. This is husn-e suluk. It's good manners, but it's not husn-e ikhlaq. System A is not talking about improving husn-e suluk. He's talking about improving husn-e ikhlaq. And if husn-e ikhlaq improves, husn-e suluk actually follows. It's an automatic, you know, consequence of that. But if you do not have husn-e ikhlaq, then it is only a drama. It's theater. Whereas inside, I am just not liking you. Oh, mashallah, Balash, you know. So you said, oh, brother, Mr. Suleman, you know, can I come over to your home and, you know, I have some questions to ask? Inside, if I'm saying, oh my God, now what? I'll have to give this crazy guy some time. Astaghfirullah, I'll just waste my time. I'd rather be doing consulting and earning 12,500 rupees per hour than to give time to this Balaj guy, you know, for free. So if that's going on inside my heart, but what I'm going to say? Oh, yeah, Balaj, I would love to have you, yaar. Yeah, sure, come on, give me a call, you know, and then I don't pick up the phone. Or then I'll make an excuse. Oh, Balaj, you know, something's going on. And, you know, there are many hundreds of ways to avoid people, and I avoid. And somebody watching me will say, system B, you know what system A, system B will say? Wow, very well-mannered, cultured guy. See the difference? So the point that I'm trying to make here is, do I have hasad? Do I have envy in my heart? If I do, then how do I take it out? You know, what about morality? How do I look at a girl? Now, anybody can look at a girl, right? But that's not the case. That's not what system A talks about. The system A talks about is, okay, what's going on inside your heart? When you look at a girl. Oh, this is a lady who demands respect. She is like my daughter or sister. She is somebody's daughter, somebody's sister. Is that how I look at a woman? Or do I look at a woman as an object of lust? Wow, you know. It'll be nice to go out on a date with this girl. You know? Now, outwardly, I may be smiling and everything, but inwardly, things are different. So, ikhlaq actually is about what's inside, not what's about outside. Now, do you think I can explain this better than how Taqi Ismail Sahib explained this? MashaAllah, oh my God, that's 500 rupees coming. But of course, he's a scholar and the way he explained it is unbelievable. So, coming back to scarcity versus abundance mentality, whatever is the mentality, whatever is that paradigm is going to have a reflection on our attitude. So the scarcity mentality person is going to feel jealous, angry, hurt, unfair, even though this guy may be running a fever, maybe. You know, this guy may be, you know, pre-diabetic. He may be feeling more thirsty than others. Maybe he has more, his metabolism is higher. Maybe. He needs more water. Some people, you know, they don't feel that thirsty. But still he'll feel angry. That's what is scarcity mentality. Now, if the system says no, abundance mentality. Abundance mentality means nothing is limited in this universe. Because this universe has been created by Allah or God, and He has everything in abundance. And if Allah wants, He will give it to me. So if this guy is going to take more water, the abundance mentality person will say, let me make everybody comfortable. Let me sacrifice for him. Because if I sacrifice for this person, Allah will give me rewards. I'll get something in return from Allah. And since Allah has everything, water will come, no problem. You know, it might rain. Or we'll find a way to maybe distill the seawater. Let's take a piece of plastic and try to distill it, and you know, there's a process that you can do it, right? If there's sunlight, you can distill water, salt water, right? So his mind will go towards other stuff, distillation, sacrificing. So he might say to others, if he's a true abundance mentality person, he'll say, look guys, this guy seems to be thirsty, and we're supposed to have one glass each. So I'm giving my glass to him. So he'll take two, I'll take zero, and everybody else can have one. So everything's, you know, done. So what's going to happen now is that these people who may have had a scarcity mentality will also feel comfortable. And then abundance mentality will start to replicate itself and multiply. If you do something good, it multiplies, right? Am I making sense? So, success, you're here, you're studying, you like to get a good job, you like to be successful in life. I'm telling you, if my husn-e akhlaq, if my akhlaq do not improve, I will be miserable with even millions in my account. I'll be miserable and unhappy. Every time I'll see somebody succeed, I'll be unhappy. Every time I'll see somebody with expensive vehicle, I'll be unhappy. Every time I'll see somebody with a very beautiful wife, I'll be unhappy. So what's the point of all of this wealth and these degrees where my akhlaq is not being developed? That is why, you know, thanks to this Western education, you know, that focuses only on giving us skills through which we can earn money. Do I have skills to earn money? Yes? Oh, wow. Fantastic education. It's actually pathetic education. Because if somebody is ignorant, at least he knows he's ignorant. Here, there is an illusion of knowledge. This is the problem. See, if somebody is ill and he says, oh, I'm ill, you can do something about it, this person. If somebody says, no, I'm okay, and he's ill, you cannot do anything about this person. This education is disastrous. If it is not blended, there's nothing wrong with learning skills to earn money. There's nothing wrong with it. But the illusion that it creates is that I'm an educated man, and that's it. I don't need to have access to any other knowledge, right? And then we go into our practical lives, and then we are miserable, we are envious, we're burning our hearts out. And then all of that inner state then reflects on our health. And then now we are under stress, we are, you know, getting heart attacks, different illnesses, our immunities are disturbed. There's a very huge group in Pakistan. I've been invited to do stress management for them. So stress management is a day's workshop. But the CEO of the group now happens to be a very enlightened person. So he spoke to me over the phone. He said, Mr. Suleman, I don't think in one day you'll deliver what I want. So I said, what? And he said, listen, my people are under stress because of their internal attitudes. Envy and competition and all of these things. So can't you just come up with a custom design course? And even if you want to take 2 days, take 2 days. That's not an issue. But design something for me, you know, that can tell these people that, you know, life is not only about money. Life is not only about, you know, promotions. He says there's so much leg pulling going on in this institution. So now I'm standing here, working with you who are about to get into professional life. And on the other spectrum, here are people who are very successful, and their CEO is bringing me in to do what? To do the intervention that should have been done at this stage. Do you think it's going to be easy for me to get results? Very difficult. But if we could have worked with those people when they were students, that was the right time to invest. So people, really, I'm telling you, I was not even expecting such a powerful talk. Only 15 minutes. But my God. First time in my life, I got to realize the difference between these things. And then I can see, really, I know people who are genuinely, they have the goodness of people in their heart, and they're very genuine, you know. And such genuine people, even if they correct you a little harshly, you don't feel it. Because you sense that, you know, inner state of that person. Like they say, you know, what you are is shouting so loud at me, I cannot hear what you're saying. And then I started to reflect upon people who are so polite on the outside. But you know, it always appears like it's fake. You know, you always feel uncomfortable with such people. Because they are fake. You know, there's an airport called Newark Airport. I remember, you know, I went up to the counter. This lady was so polite, and you know, and I said, well, okay. And then I don't know if I wanted to ask another question or something. So after like 5 minutes, I came back to ask a question, maybe about the gate or maybe, I don't know what. So I came back, her shift had ended. So she was stepping out of the, you know, that counter, right? She had a small bag and she was stepping out. So since she had served me, so it was very natural for me to ask her. I said, excuse me, you know, and the way she looked at me, so rude. No, you can talk to the other person. I said, what happened? What's going on? Just 5 minutes ago, 10 minutes ago, you are the most pleasant person on the face of this earth. And after 10 minutes, you're so rude. Why? No secret? Because this poor girl, affected by system B, has been taught that good manners and good ikhlaq is this. Not this. And that is why I really like what Kavi says, because Kavi is a person who is challenging the system B, right? So he's a rebel of system B in the US, right? So he talks about character ethic and the personality ethic. He says personality ethic versus character ethic. Faisal, do you have that video about that character ethic? Personality ethic? My video is a video, sorry.
नहीं भाई कभी के वीडियो हम
so what he's saying is that in the past less than 100 years ago there was a shift. Before, people used to talk about character, what is inside you, and then less than 100 years ago it shifted to personality ethic, to techniques, to ways and means of, you know, pleasing others. You know, they'll teach you how to smile, you know, smile at your customer. Meet your customer with a smile. So this, here you're talking about meet the customer with a smile. How about saying, meet the customer with a genuine, sincere desire to be of assistance to him. Instead of saying, you know, close the sale, how about saying that look at the need of the customer and ensure that we are honest and fair to that person. So I met a very honest and fair salesman during the eat time. So I took my boys, three of them, and I said, I'll buy them dresses, right? So I went to this mall, Dolman Mall in Tyreek Road. So I said, you know, so I was looking around and I felt that all these clothes were beyond my budget. And I wanted to buy shalwar kameez for the boys, three of them. So I said to this, so I went to one shop, the other shop, like third shop, and I said, you know, don't you have any dress that fits within this budget? He said, sir, let me give you some advice. If you want clothes within this budget, you will not find that in Dolman Mall. But you will find good quality, same quality clothes in the next mall that we have. I don't know, Glamour One or something. If you go to that mall, there you'll find multiple stores with this budget. I say, yeah, thank you very much for this advice. Just pray for me. So this means this guy genuinely was looking after my interest, right? He was not focused on making a sale to me, which was unfair. He gave me right advice. I went to the other place. And lo and behold, the same quality clothes, but in that range, I think there's something to do with the mall. Now, I did not make a sale from the shop. But do you think I have respect for that person? Okay, he did get rewarded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I'm sure. I felt very happy. And if I were to come across him again, I'll meet him with respect. So I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give all of us the abundance mentality, not the scarcity mentality. A life which talks about, you know, sacrifice and looking after other people's interests and sometimes even sacrificing our interests for other people. Because when we take up a life of service and a life of sacrifice and a life of taking care of others, when we worry about making other people happy, who gets happiness in return? We. The happiest people are the ones who work very hard to make other people happy. The most content people are the ones who have other people's interests in their hearts. Money is not going to help us buy happiness and contentment. It's not going to happen. It's what's inside us. Okay, I want to show you a video of Stephen Covey.
The development of the Seven Habits began with a study I completed in 1976. I wanted to study the success idea in America and how it evolved. So I got into the popular success literature going back for 200 years. This included many, many books, magazine articles, annotated bibliographies, summaries, reviews. I literally tapped into thousands and thousands of sources, either directly or indirectly. As I worked, I started to sense a pattern. As soon as I sensed this pattern, I looked for evidence of it, and the evidence was everywhere. The basic finding was this. For the first 150 years, almost the entire focus of the literature was on character, on principles, on what we might call the character ethic. Attributes such as integrity, fidelity, courage, compassion, contribution, responsibility, justice. These findings became the basis for writing the Seven Habits of Highly Effective People. And then, because of many, many societal forces, the emphasis gradually shifted. In the early 1900s, particularly in the 20s and the 30s, away from the character ethic to what we might call the personality ethic, which focused more on techniques than on principles. You are probably familiar with many books that illustrate the literature of the personality ethic. They basically deal with how to take care of yourself, how to look good, how to dress in particular ways, how to create the right image. In other words, the personality ethic focuses on how to appear to be rather than on how to actually be. Many of these techniques have real merit. However, if they don't have their roots in the character ethic, if they don't have their roots in principles, they won't have the power to create enduring effectiveness. For example, what if people learn techniques of influencing others, but they're fundamentally duplicitous or deceitful in their character? What if they really wanted to use people to build their own economic success? They might develop smoothness in their relationships so that they can have their own personal ends achieved, money, fame, glory, whatever. They really couldn't care less about contribution or service, purpose, adding value, helping others. How much trust would you have in them? How willing would you be to follow them or to rely upon them when things get tough? You know, one time I had a student come to me and say, "How am I doing in your class?" I looked him in the eye and said, "You really know how you're doing, don't you? A lot better than I do. How are you doing?" And he kind of looked down squeamishly. "Well, not too good, I guess. I just had kind of a rough time lately, and Maybe I haven't applied myself as much as I should have. You really came to find out how well you'd psyched me out, how well you'd psyched out the system, isn't that right? When in fact, you kind of know in your heart how you're doing. Well, how am I doing, he said. How are you doing? Let's focus on what's really happening, not on what's appearing to happen. You see, this whole personality ethic with its technique focus is like the tip of an iceberg. The tip, or that part which is seen on the surface by others, it's above the water. The character ethic is like the great mass of the iceberg under the water. People often do no work in the foundation, where the great mass is, where the greatest long-term impact is. Too many people give all their energy and focus to the tip of the iceberg, that is, to learning techniques that others can see. You see this even in organizations, not just individuals. You see, programs change, practices change, principles do not change. If we help individuals and organizations to internalize principles, they will know how to adapt the practices to address specific situations. Let me emphasize that techniques have their place. They're very important. I really mean that. I mean, you want good human relations techniques, public relations techniques, communication techniques, management techniques. But when we use techniques to cover our own lack of character, they become manipulative. They undermine trust and confidence. You see, what we really need is the character ethic. And that's essentially what the Seven Habits is about. This material is based on an inside-out approach, meaning we give our first energies to our own character development before we focus on techniques or how to be more effective with others. Gandhi beautifully demonstrated this principle once. A mother came to him and said, "Would you help my child reduce the amount of sugar he is eating?" Gandhi paused, thought, and answered, "Well, talk to me in a week." A week later, the mother asked him again, and he talked to the boy, and the boy agreed. And the mother said, "Why didn't you talk with him last week?" Gandhi smiled and said, "You don't understand. Last week, I too was eating sugar." Unless we work on our character, we will not develop trustworthiness. And trustworthiness is built by the combination of both character and competency. We could have all of the ability in the world, but if we don't have the basic character to be reliable, to take responsibility, others will soon learn to distrust us. They're fearing that we are just trying to meet our own ends, perhaps at their expense. In my opinion, unless we return to the character ethic, we won't have the basic foundation of trustworthiness. That's what leads to trust, which is needed to build effective interpersonal relationships. In the final analysis, what we are communicates far more eloquently than anything we say or do. I love the quote of Henry David Thoreau, "For every 1,000 hacking at the leaves of evil, there is one striking at the root." In other words, let's work primarily on the roots to begin with and build a foundation of trustworthiness. This is one of the key areas of focus in the Seven Habits, to build character and competence and to restore trustworthiness and trust in our lives, in the lives of our families, our organizations. Trust and trustworthiness really are the basis of personal and interpersonal leadership. It's the foundation of all true effectiveness.
Video, Rishan Saab, what was your key learning out of this video? Three key lessons of this video.
So personality is just merely what you like, show to people, but it's really important to build your character, which goes like way much more deeper. So, and automatically if you work on your character, your personality will reflect on that. And other than that, that it's the video says that it's a personality ethic that appear to be rather than actual be. So this is what we should like as in work as a human being.
Wow, mashallah, you got the point, mashallah, happy. Haan janab, Surur sahab, what was the, any other learning that you got out of this video?
Sir, basically the character ethics are related to the principle that are into the roots of a person. So if the roots are strong, then the leaves will grow good. Similarly, there was another thing related to trustworthiness. Okay, if the character are strong and the person is ethically strong within inner, so he would be trusted by others. Similarly, the personality ethics deal with the appearance, physical related things, but the person isn't innately mean, matlab ke he's not, he's just tagged to pretend something, but he is not actually.
Good. Okay. So I'm going to have this video also as part of our quiz tomorrow. Where is this available on YouTube, right? So why don't you search and give us a link? These videos are also available on YouTube. Okay, any what other homework that I gave you? How's it coming along with your mentees? Let's see how mentee is coming along. So, Maham. Maham? Oh, she's gone. Acha. Hamza sahab, tell me how is it coming along with the mentees, your mentee? Remember we have selected one? Oh, Hamza, okay. Just Hamza. I'll call you SM Hamza.
Sir, recently to koi communication nahi ho pai mentees se because we were busy doing our assignments and stuff. So, filhal to abhi us.
So last class you could not share.
Last class was not shared. Yes. Usse pichle time tak to communication thi, but busy is tarah ke ho gaye the ke time nahi mila.
Okay. Aisa Hamza sahab, so how's?
Same.
Did you get the chance to?
The last week was very hectic. Very hectic. Sorry for that.
No. Sure. Okay, no problem. Oh, poor guys. Oh, miskeen. But how can you be in the university on Sunday when the air conditioning is off? MPR, what is that? Multiple rooms. Okay, we'll have air conditioning there. Okay, good. Okay, so today there's a very, very important topic that we'll discuss. Remember we were talking about the ponies, and we talked about, you know, what will you do with when the reality will change? We'll cross the bridge when we get there. There's another pony which is all is fine. Okay? All is fine. How they go? Okay, see on YouTube, this is that video. Character and Personality by Stephen Covey. Views. Wow. Okay. Okay. So you can make sure that you go through it once again, and it'll be a good reference for you to talk to your mentee also, right? Okay. Good. So all is fine. Bismillah. So how does this pony operate? This pony operates by saying, you know, since everything is going to be fine anyway, and all is fine, why do we need a vision? Because vision actually gives you direction. So I really don't need a direction. So if I do not need a direction, I don't need a vision. So I'll give you an example through a story. Many years ago, this young man came to my training and he showed up later on in my office, and he said, you know, Suleman Saab, I would like you to come to my marriage ceremony, Walima. And I'd really like you to show up and come and stuff. I said, okay, sure, if I'm in Karachi, I'll come. So I told him, just give me the date, the time, and location. I'll just mark that in my schedule, and if I'm in Karachi, I'll come. So it was the earlier months, right? Something like February, March, and he's giving me a date in December. Say, suppose, 17 December. I said, okay. So the next question I asked him was, which usually people would ask, who is the lucky girl? And he said, well, I don't know. I said, what do you mean? He said, you know, I'll say it in Urdu and I'll translate. And he said, asal mein wo time hai na, to ami dhoon rahi hai, to us waqt tak inshallah ami dhoon lengi. I said, but you told me that even the marriage hall is reserved. He said, yeah, it's reserved, but you know, we'll find someone by that time. I said, okay. So I said to him, that your mother will find a girl by that time. So I said to him, since your mother is searching for a girl, have you given her your preferences? He said, what do you mean? I said, everybody has preferences, right? So he said, no, whatever my mother will select, I will marry. I said, come on. That doesn't work that way. Everyone has preferences. Why don't you tell your mother what sort of girl you want, and then she'll search for such a girl. He said, no. Whoever my mom will select, I will marry. So I remember there in Chicago, you know, one of my friends, he came to me and he said, oh, Suleman, you know, you got married and you have so many relatives in the US and I have no one in the US. Why don't you help me find a girl? Even though that I never got married into my relatives. So I said, okay. He was an engineer, nice guy. I said, okay. And he was some Khan, so I will not tell you the name, but Mr. say Ahmed Khan. So I said, okay, Ahmed, tell me, do you have some preferences? He said, yes. Two things. I said, what? He said, one, she should have long hair. I said, what do you mean? He said, long hair. Okay, and awaaz achhi honi chahiye. She should have a nice voice. I said, anything more? He said, no. I said, are you serious? I mean, you have no preference for education, height, you know, whether she's fat, she's thin, family, you know, just these two things. And I felt so uncomfortable talking to my relatives and telling them that, you know, my friend is looking for a girl who should have these two things. And I actually did it. I said, well, you know, he's a very nice guy, but he has his preferences. And I could not understand why somebody would have such preferences. In long hair, I could understand, but voice. And then when I came to Pakistan, then I saw an ad. And that ad then actually clarified everything for me. So let us show you that ad. Yeah? You know what I'm going to show you, right? Okay.
Subha subha, barish ki pehli boond jaisi. Teri awaaz ka jadoo, teri awaaz ka jadoo. Hua main deewana, chal gaya pal bhar mein. Teri awaaz ka jadoo.
Aapka phone.
Teri meherbani. Meherbani.
कुछ भी कहो साफ आवाज से फर्क पड़ता तो है तो सिर्फ यूफोन देता है आपको साफ आवाज फौरी रابطہ और वसी नेटवर्क तो आपको और क्या चाहिए
क्या हुआ
वो निकल
मुझे भी चाबी दो लाइन मारनी है
किस पे
मेरी गाड़ी के बोनट पे
मेरी पोर्श मेरी पोर्श
Really, after watching this video, you know, it reminded me of Mr. Ahmed in Chicago. And then I realized what he meant. So anyway, so this young guy, by coming back to Karachi, and I said, you know, you should have some preferences. And he kept insisting that, you know, I'll marry the girl that my mother will marry me to. So a thought came to my mind. The thought was that either this guy is a really Eastern, you know, mashallah, you know, mommy's boy, or there's a pony. And if there's a pony, then there'll be trouble. So I said, let's check it out, right? So I said to him, I said, okay, tell me, would a 200-pound lady work for you? So are there 200-pound ladies in this world? 85 kilogram. Hamza? Sure, of course, there are many. Do they get married?
Yes.
Of course they do. Do they get married to 200 pound people or maybe sometimes to people who are less in weight? So if this person really was what he was saying he was, that I'll marry anybody that mother would marry me to, so what should he have said? Okay, fine, if my mother selects. But what did he really say? No, Swamai, 200 pound. Oh no. I said, okay, would a 6.5 feet tall girl work for you? Okay, 6.5 feet tall. Swamai sahab, you know, I'm only 5'8". You know? So I said, okay. So he said, no. So I said, how about a girl who has a master, who has a black belt in karate? Would you marry a girl with a black belt in karate? And you know what he said? No, I don't even know karate. No. So I said, you know, you just said that you'll marry anybody that your mother will marry you to. And now you're saying no. Why? Because it's a pony. So the rule is that people who say that we do not know what we want definitely, passionately know what they do not want in life. Where are your manuals, guys? Meow, meow, meow. Why don't you open your manuals? Save you the pain of writing things, right? So you should be in the class with your manuals. Page number 35. So now, since we know what we do not want, it is very critical to know what we do want. If I say that everything is fine and I just move randomly, then there's a chance that we might get something that we never wanted. Okay? So let's look at this diagrammatically. Suppose you are here in, say, suppose you are in Islamabad. Okay? And from Islamabad, there's a road that goes to, say, Mari. And there's a road that goes to Abbottabad, and there's a road that goes to Lahore, and there's a road that goes to Rawalpindi. The four roads. Now, a road goes from Islamabad to Mari. What is one of the sufficient evidences that there is a road from Islamabad to Mari? So one of the sufficient evidences is that you go to Mari and make an announcement. Is there anybody here from Islamabad? If a single hand is raised, It means there is a road from Islamabad to Murray because this person is there. How did this person get there? If there was no road, if there was no way. The same applies for Rawalpindi, for Lahore, for Abbottabad. If you go to Abbottabad and you make that announcement, is there anybody here from Islamabad? And even if a single hand is raised, there is a road from Islamabad to Abbottabad. Now the issue is that just like there's a road from Islamabad to Murray, Rawalpindi, Lahore and Abbottabad, there's a road from Islamabad to the CMH, the Combined Military Hospital. There's a road from Islamabad to the dialysis center of the Shifa Hospital. There is a road from Islamabad to the family breakdown land, a place where the husband is here and the wife is here and the kids are there. And from Islamabad, there is a road from Islamabad to Jahannam, hell. Now, if someone argues, no, there's no road from Islamabad to CMS, then we can say, okay, let's apply the same rule. How about going to CMS and asking a question? Is there anybody here from Islamabad? What do you think will happen? Half of the people say, yes, we are from Islamabad. It means there is a road from Islamabad to the CMS. There is a road from Islamabad to the Shifa Hospital Dialysis Center, where people with failed kidneys will come. There is a road from Islamabad to the family breakdown land. And there is a road from Islamabad to Jahannam. So once we were doing training in Dubai, and we had some European people in the training, some. And so one of them said, no, Mr. Suleman, there is no road from Dubai to hell. So I thought maybe either he is joking with me or he's confused. And I said, well, this guy is a Christian and even Christians believe there's heaven and hell. So I said, what do you mean? He said, no, Mr. Suleman, there's no road from Dubai to hell. There's a highway. I said, that's not nice to speak about a city in that manner. You know where you live? He said, no, Mr. Suleman, we know. You don't know, we know. So a guy came to me and he said, but how would you apply that rule here? Can you go to hell and make an announcement? I said, no, there's another argument that works here. The argument that works here is that there's once upon a time, there was a town, it was called Madinatul Munawwara. And there was a man who lived in that town. His name is Muhammad bin Abdullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who was the Prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. During his time, from his city, and with him not wanting this to happen, a road led from Medina to hell. So I said, well, if a road can go from Medina to hell, then don't be so amazed about Karachi or Islamabad or Dubai. If a Prophet of Allah failed to block a road from his city to hell, so what do you think about Karachi or Dubai? So there is a road. Now if you look at that argument, that pony which says all is fine, do you think all is fine? Murray may be fine, but do you think CMH is fine? Lahore may be fine, but do you think the dialysis center is fine? Do you think that any one of us would want his kidneys to fail and be on dialysis? I don't know, is there anybody here who would like to see that happen? We don't want to see our kidneys fail, right? So all is not fine. So how does this argument work? The argument goes like this: if all is fine, which means we don't need a direction. Suppose if the only option we have is Abbottabad, Murray, Rawalpindi, and Lahore, and all those four towns are absolutely okay, then all is fine is true. Then we do not need a direction, which means like I'll leave randomly, and any town that I get to is fine. How does that apply to looking for a wife? Suppose Suleman here tells his mother, Mom, I need 4 qualities in my wife. So the mom will say, okay, mashallah. So let me take a pen and write them down. So he might say things like blonde hair, blue eyes, you know, PhD, extremely rich, extremely kind, you know, and a little stupid, you know, religious, wearing the niqab so that only I can see her hair and not the whole town. And so he gives, puts these, you know, requirements, demands. So the mother goes around and she finds 4 girls who meet all the criteria. All of them have blue eyes, all of them are blonde, all of them wear the niqab, all of them are rich, all of them, you know, are you know, educated with PhDs, and all of them are a little stupid. And mother says, hey, Suleman, here are 4 girls. Amna, Khatija, Lubna, and Christina. Okay? So what do you want? What do you think? So most probably Suleman will say, Mom, if all of those 4 girls meet the criteria, then why don't you select the one that you're most comfortable with? Because for me, all of them are fine. You select one. Right? So, but if all is fine, then he doesn't need a direction, right? Which means he does not need a vision. Makes sense. But the issue is, all is not fine. Murray is fine, but CMH is not fine. Islamabad is fine, but family breakdown land is not fine. Which means we need a direction. We need a direction. Because if I leave without a direction, and if I go randomly, there's a risk that instead of going here, I might end up here. And most of the time, when we find out, it is too late. Once the kidneys fail, there's nothing you can do about them. You cannot reverse it. Once somebody dies, you can't reverse it. If we need a direction, which means we need a vision. So all is fine is a pony. Is that point clear? Perfectly clear? Okay. Which means without a direction, we are at a risk. Okay, since when is it allowed in class to talk to each other? Since when did that permission was given? Okay. So it's not allowed because, you know, I'm sure you must be talking about something very important, but it is extremely disruptive to the instructor, whoever the instructor is. So if you really need to speak to each other, let me know. I'll just pause for like 5 minutes, let you talk, and then we can continue. If you have a question, you know, I'm here. Yeah? Okay. Now, without a direction, we are at a risk. Hassan, why are we at a risk without a direction? Because if I go randomly, what's the risk? I might end up in CMH. Okay, I might end up in Murray also. A risk does not mean that damage will happen. A risk means that damage might happen.
But here, if you end up in hell, so damage will be there.
Damage will be?
Damage will going to happen.
Yeah, in hell.
Yeah.
Yeah, of course.
So then the risk is there.
Of course, it's there. That's what I'm saying. Without a direction, we are at a risk. We are at a risk. A risk of going to hell, a risk of going to CMH, a risk of going to the dialysis center, there is a risk. That is exactly what I'm saying. Without a direction, we are at a risk. Without a direction, we are at a risk. Is that point clear? Okay. So I was in Islamabad and we had some finance people, including Dr. Zeeshan. Many years ago, I was doing a workshop and Dr. Zeeshan came over to Islamabad to attend this workshop. And these guys said to me, "No, Mr. Suleman, this sentence is not correct." I said, "Why?" They said, "Because you have not studied finance." I said, "What do you mean?" They said, "Mr. Suleman, this sentence is incorrect because even if you do have a direction, there is always a finite amount of risk. For example, if my car is fine, the brakes are okay, and everything's fine, somebody else will come and hit me, right?" They said, "If you do not add one word, the sentence is incorrect, and that one word was, without a direction, we are at a severe, Umar, risk." Without our direction, we are at a severe risk. Is that point clear? Now, without a clear vision, we do not have a direction, right? If I do not have a clear long-term vision, if I do not have a destination, I would not know whether to turn left or right at this juncture. So Lewis Carroll has put it so beautifully, right? When that Alice comes to that fork, right? And there is this Cheshire, I don't know how to spell that, Cheshire cat on the tree. And Alice asks that cat, "Which road shall I take?" And the cat says, "Where do you want to go?" And Alice says, "I do not know." And the cat says, "Then it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. If I do not have a clear vision of what sort of health I want, then if food is placed in front of me, I'll eat everything that I like. But if I have a very clear objective of what sort of health I want, then I'm going to select some foods that will match my vision and some foods that take me away from my vision, right? I will know what to eat and what not to eat. Is that point clear? Is this common sense, right? Okay. Let's go back. Professor. So without a clear vision, we do not have a direction. So if A implies B and B implies C, then it means A implies C, which means without a clear vision, we are at a severe risk. So without a clear vision, we are at a severe risk. I'm sorry. Okay. I don't know about your mobile phone that has been squashed or squished or whatever. Okay. This is one of the most critical conclusions of this whole course. If you were to understand this point, a revolution can come in your life. Without a clear vision, I'm at a severe risk. So now if you look at the different roles that I have, if my vision in my role of a father is not clear, my kids are at a severe risk. If my vision in the role of being a husband is not clear, my poor wife is at a severe risk. If my vision in my role of a son is not clear, my parents are at a severe risk. If my vision in my role of self, my self-health is not clear, my health is at a severe risk. If my vision for my country in my role of a prime minister is not clear, the whole nation is at severe risk. Now, risk does not mean that damage will happen. It means that a damage might happen. Somebody said to me, but why would people be so unwise and stupid to not have visions and live a life full of risk? I said, well, that's people's nature. That's how we are. Do people not drive without seat belts? Do we not know that if an accident were to happen, I'll go through the windscreen? People know that, right? But still we do not put on seat belts. Human beings have this great affinity of living life with risks. That's what human beings are. So what is that, what does system 8 say about that? It's called ghaflat. What is ghaflat?
Ignorance.
Ghaflat. Oblivion. Ghaflat is oblivion. Oblivion means the plane is in a skydive situation. It's going to strike the ground. And I'm busy playing Counter-Strike. I'm busy enjoying the orange juice that has been served to me in the plane. I'm oblivious of what's coming at me. Ghaflat. Because human beings are capable of living with ghaflat, living with oblivion, ignorance. You know, it's not ignorance, it's oblivion, oblivious to everything. And then it actually transcends from one area of our life, one role of our life, and it just basically permeates into everything that we do. If I'm eating junk food, not exercising, leading a very unhealthy lifestyle, is what is this? It's oblivion. It's ghaflat because I know the consequences, but I choose to ignore them. And there are certain lifestyles that are designed to create ghaflat. You're busy. So if I become very busy, and I feel that, you know, sometimes on these great vacations I feel that. I become very less conscious of Allah and less conscious of my responsibilities towards Allah because I'm so busy in enjoying that vacation. So lo and behold, I show up in this place. And actually my mistake was that I had not researched on this place and I went there just to take a look. Because somebody told me, just go and take a look. Langkawi in Malaysia. So how many of you have gone to Langkawi? Not yet? Okay. You've gone there? Okay. So Balash will tell you how beautiful that place is. So I thought I'll go there for a couple of hours and I got mesmerized. And I ended up staying 2 days, 3 days, even though I did not have the money. So I, you know, I did all these creative ways of, you know, of finding my way around without a lot of money. And I had money, but it was in my car on the mainland, which I parked, you know. It was in the car, but I never thought I'm going to stay more than that time, so I didn't bring cash. And that beauty and the activities, wow. So let's look at some of the slides of Langkawi and see how Langkawi is, you know. It's considered as one of the most beautiful places on the face of this earth, one of the most beautiful islands on the face of this earth. And I've liked it so much that I think I've visited like 3-4 times now. Once I took my dad, then I took my wife, you know. I just can't seem to have enough of this place. How long did you stay there?
I was
2 days. 2 days? Wow. In Lanka? Did you fly into Lanka or did you take a ferry? Took a ferry, okay. So I go to Langkawi to scuba dive. Here's Langkawi of Malaysia. How's that? So what you can do, that if you can rent a good jet ski and make friends with that guy so that he can allow you to kind of move around. So I took my wife, took a jet ski, and took around these islands. There are around 100 islands. And all of this is called Langkawi. Yeah. So, you know, because you get so caught up in all of that stuff, you know. And there's so many things to do there. And you always feel you don't have enough time. There are lakes, there are, you know, waterfalls, forest. You can rent a small bike and you drive around, around, around. And not to talk about prayer, shopping, tax-free, phenomenal malls, you know. Anyway, now coming back to that discussion, so without a clear vision, we are a severe risk. So I'll share with you one story. Of course, I'll not name the person. So when we started off teaching, 2002, we started off with the time management workshop, right? So early on, a person came to my workshop and he said, when is the next workshop going to be held? And I said, next month. And he said, you know, I'd like to come to that workshop again. So I said, no, I don't think you should come next month. Why don't you give it another like 3-4 months and probably things will further refine. He said, I want to come next month. So he's insisting. So when we had this small argument, then he said, okay, Suleman, I'll come to your office and I'll explain something to you. So after a couple of days, he shows up. He said, look, I'm not coming to your workshop next month because I've not understood what you taught. Actually, I've understood a lot what you have taught, and I can see that it will really benefit my life because I really need to manage my time because I have only 12 years to live. And he was like 38 at that time. So now if somebody who has been with you for 3 days and he comes to you and says, I've only 12 years to live, what would you say? Would you not be curious? I said, is everything okay? He said, yeah. I said, if you do not mind, and if it's not a secret, can you share with me what happened? He said, sure. So he told me his story. He said, like 2-3 years ago, I used to be in Saudi Arabia and you know, working. And he said, I developed hypertension, blood pressure. So I went to a doctor, and the doctor said, well, you should take these pills every day. So, fine. Now, hypertension is called the silent killer. Why is that? Can anybody tell me why is it called a silent killer? Professor, when was the break? Huh? We didn't decide? It's break time. Remember? You guys forgot about the break. You became oblivion. You became oblivious to the world. You got so caught up in this story. And suddenly you were transported to Saudi Arabia. Okay. So break, right? Okay. So we'll take a break for what, half an hour?